Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's wonderful to see so many people at this lunch presentation. It's wonderful to have such a buzz in the room. Thank you all very much for sparing the time to come and hear about this very interesting and exciting book that has been produced, Developing China, The Remarkable Impact of Foreign Direct Investment. I'm Tim Summers. I'm very pleased to be able to introduce to you today the two key gentlemen who have made this event happen, Michael Enright and Merle Heinrich. I think neither of them need much introduction for this audience. Michael, as I think most of you will know, has been working for many years on issues of competitiveness, regional economic development, and international business strategy. He's director of Enright, Scott and Associates, which is a firm that specializes in strategic consulting for governments and major corporations. Michael joined the University of Hong Kong as the San Hong Kai Professor of Business Administration in 1996, after spending time at the Harvard Business School. He also directs the Asia Pacific Competitiveness Program at the Hong Kong Institute for Economics and Business Strategy, was a founding director of the Competitiveness Institute, and a founder of the China Dialogues Network. Merle is executive chairman of Global Sources, Asia's leading business-to-business media company, which focuses on global trade. He founded the company in 1970 with the firm conviction that free and mutually beneficial trade would help drive global economic prosperity. The company's focus has been to try and remove the uncertainty inherent in cross-border trade by providing reliable information. And extending this work, Merle more recently founded the Hinrich Foundation, an independent philanthropic organization which has been established for the charitable purpose of promoting sustainable global trade. And it's the foundation that has supported the work that has led to today's presentation. So once again, thank you very much for coming. I will now hand over to Mr. Hinrich for some opening remarks.
It's wonderful to have you with us today. And a special welcome to our council generals and representatives of the Hong Kong government, a number of business leaders here this afternoon. And we have a number of students with us here as well, who are applying for their doctorates. I hope that the presentation is of help to you. We're here basically, and I thank you for your interest in understanding the true impact of foreign direct investment in China. The Hinrich Foundation's mission is really to promote sustainable global trade. We advance this objective by fostering international trade policy research, supporting trade-related education and training, and cultivating export-led job creation. We firmly believe that by advancing global trade, we contribute to the economic development of participating countries, innovation in industries, and improve basically the standards of the customers and the participants in those countries and companies. The Hinrich Foundation's intent and the genesis of this book, Developing China, The Remarkable Impact of Foreign Direct Investment, was to better understand and explain the experience of China and the foreign investing enterprises that invested in China over the last 30 years. After considering several authors, and we did look afar, that in May 2015, we commissioned Michael Enright and his team at Enright, Scott and Associates to carry out the research, and we were very pleased that we did. And thanks to his research, for the first time, the full impacts of FDI have been measured. Using economic impact analysis, it is possible to identify things like the fact that 33% of the China's GDP was as a result of foreign direct investment in the year 2013, and in the same year, 27% of its employment was represented by some form of FDI. This is a robust and outstanding study on how a single country planned and executed an FDI strategy that completely changed its economic trajectory. It is a study which details the pros and cons, the positive and negative spillovers of FDI from a country perspective, as well as from a corporate investor and a community view. It details the implications and contributions made by the transfer of intellectual property, the importance of distribution channels, the development of supply chains, management training, and of course, the financial investments that were made. Among the first of those foreign investing companies in China were the Hong Kong pioneers. The Hong Kong companies that were the earliest investors in infrastructure and export processing at the outset of China's reform period. I could not let this opportunity pass without recognizing the courage and creativity shown by Hong Kong companies who forged a path for other foreign investors to follow. When China embarked on its FDI program, it desperately needed to enable the modernization of its industries and provide employment for its people. The foreign investors knew that if they could build capacity in the China market, they could also secure their global competitive positions. The outcome is that China has become, as we all know, a major global economy and has elevated over 600 million people from poverty. And hundreds of foreign companies have become much more competitive through their investments in China. It is the Hinrich Foundation's hope that other countries and other corporations will be able to maximize the benefits of foreign direct investment to further alleviate poverty, create stronger global economic partnerships, and to enhance sustainable global trade. This research is equally applicable to the developing country, the developed countries, such as the United States and Europe, looking to develop their infrastructures, which are some badly needed investments to be made, and prospective contributions to the next generation of industries by attracting FDI. Host countries need to develop policies that create consistency for investors and sustainability for industries and communities. Through this book, we at the Hinrich Foundation would like to encourage investors and host countries to create mutually beneficial partnerships for leveraging the impact of FDI. And now I would like to introduce Michael. Michael, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Merle. A couple of quick acknowledgments in addition to obviously Merle Hinrich of the Hinrich Foundation. We have Catherine Diaz and Steve Olson, also of the foundation. So again, very warm welcome to you. And we also have two of my colleagues from Enright Scott & Associates, David Sanderson and Sophie Zhang, in the back of the room. They're going to correct me later for all the things I get wrong. Again, as many of you know, I've been based in Hong Kong for about 20 years now, just over 20 years. And during that time, obviously, a lot has gone on in the region. A lot, clearly, with respect to China. A lot with respect to Hong Kong. And in many ways, Hong Kong is still right in the center of so much of what's going on in the regional economy that this is a good place to have this discussion. Shameless book plug. Again, we understand there'll be some copies available at the end of the session. The background for this project is pretty straightforward. I mean, globally today, we're seeing pushback against the notion of globalization, questioning the value of international trade, international investment. Clearly, we've seen that discussion in the U.S., but we've also seen it in places like China, you know, Indonesia, India, other places around the region. And as the global economy has slowed, and as this sort of pressure has mounted against foreign invested enterprises, they've obviously felt themselves in that environment, a changing environment. At the same time, if we look at studies of foreign investment, there are a lot of academic studies which tend to be directional. Is foreign investment, you know, have a positive or a negative impact on, be it GDP, productivity, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a lot of useful information that can be had from that. But by the nature of those sorts of analyses, they tend to be coarse indicators. Hard to get the right variables, hard to do the right analysis. I'll come back to that a little later. Or the other type of studies we tend to see are sort of compilations of facts and figures without a whole lot of analysis behind it. Oh, this country received this amount of investment, foreign companies maybe provide this number of jobs at a surface level, usually without an analysis of what really goes on behind that. And in our view, because of the limited analysis that's out there, that few governments have a complete picture of the benefits or the costs, for that matter, that foreign investment involves with their economy. Few companies and source countries have a good handle on the complete impact that their companies or their organizations have on host countries. And as a result, the policy debates tend to be in sound bites and prejudices rather than based on firm data and analysis. And as a result, benefits are lost on both sides. Often the countries lose potential benefits, and obviously the companies lose potential benefits as well. So in terms of this project, as Merle indicated, we started discussing this in May of 2015. And the idea was to use China as a test case for the obvious reasons. The size of the economy, the importance, at least the perceived importance in the past of foreign investment, but also the fact that foreign companies have been under a certain amount of pressure in China, and China may be a bit at a crossroads as to its approach towards foreign investment. But also, increasingly, we see countries around the world, particularly developing countries, looking to China as an example, if not a model, as to how to deal with economic development in general and with foreign investment in particular. And so what we decided to do with the support of the foundation was really run the table, take a look at all of the aspects that we thought were important in understanding the impact of foreign investment on China's economy. So we reviewed the evolution of Chinese policy towards foreign investment and how that evolved in a step-by-step fashion and the reasons behind that, which are often not well understood outside of China. A second is to review all the academic and think tank literature. There's a huge amount of literature out there in English, and even larger amount in Chinese that, again, the international community is largely unaware of. Yes, we compiled all the facts and figures about the investment and where it's coming from, where it's going to in terms of locations and sectors in China. But what's more interesting to us was then applying the tools of economic impact analysis to try to get a sense of the impact of the investment, not just the foreign investment enterprises themselves, but the ripple effects back through the supply chains, through the employee expenditures, etc. And I'll come back to that in a couple of minutes. We also tried to get some more granular information, looking at specific case studies of cities in China and the impact of foreign investment on the individual cities, and also looking at sets of companies, or in some cases, individual companies, in terms of their impact on China. And quite frankly, we found historically only one company that had done what we thought was sort of the gold standard in terms of identifying their own impact on China's economy, and that was Coca-Cola, and they did that study in 1999, and they haven't updated it since. So it's really sort of an empty field there. And then we also did our own econometric analysis mirroring the academic and think tank literature that I won't really go into detail today based on time. And please do feel free to start eating. I come from a large Irish family, and we always talk over each other at the dinner table, so please do start eating. Don't worry about that. I'll speak over it. One thing that we think is critical in terms of this work is the timing. Because in our view, China's approach towards foreign investment really is at something of a crossroads. On the one hand, we see the apparent pushback in terms of foreign companies perhaps being preferentially targeted with legal and regulatory actions. We see even additional support more than usual for indigenous Chinese companies in a number of sectors. We also see that in policy and academic circles in China, it's almost become fashionable to either claim that, well, we didn't really need all that foreign investment, or we don't necessarily need that foreign investment today, or if we needed it in the past and today, we certainly won't need it tomorrow to develop the economy that we're looking to develop. And then, of course, you know, numerous press attacks on foreign companies seem designed to remind foreign companies that in China they sort of serve at the pleasure of the Chinese government. However, there are signs on the other side as well. The draft foreign investment law that's been circulated is actually quite liberal. It proposes moving China more from an ex-ante approval situation for foreign investment to an ex post reporting, regulatory, administrative, legal framework for foreign investment, at least for the vast majority of the foreign investment going into China, that is actually much more similar to what we would see in most OECD countries than has been the case in the past. And we also see that China will need some cover as Chinese companies go international. We see increasingly countries asking about reciprocity for their companies. And in addition, as China pushes to try to meet its target GDP growth rates, and to do so without running into financial troubles, foreign investment is actually a tried and proven mechanism for developing within China. Be it a consumption-oriented economy, be it a technology-oriented economy, be it an innovation-oriented economy, or a services-oriented economy, foreign invested enterprises are at the cutting edge of all of those things in China. So really, as I said, we think we're at a bit of a crossroads, and that China could go either direction in terms of becoming less or more restrictive going forward. So that's why we think the timing of this work is important. One of the key features in looking at Chinese policy towards foreign investment and foreign invested enterprises obviously has been the step-by-step nature, right? We've seen it go step-by-step in terms of geography, first the special economic zones, then adding the open cities, then opening most of the coastal provinces, then opening selective areas of the interior, and then pretty much opening the rest of the country more or less, not quite on equal footing, but more or less equal footing to foreign investment. And this has also been step-by-step in terms of the sectors. First, export-oriented manufacturing, then manufacturing that could also sell to the domestic market, then certain services, and the gradually expanding set of sectors. And also in terms of corporate forms, starting with the contractual joint ventures and the equity joint ventures to the wholly foreign-owned enterprises to foreign holding companies, et cetera, et cetera. And that's all, you know, clear that that process has been step-by-step. And it's also clear that it's been very frustrating to many foreign enterprises. But what a lot of people outside of China don't remember is that when China started opening to foreign investment, to a first approximation, there was no indigenous private economy either, right? It was a state economy. So it wasn't a matter of China having the administrative, regulatory, and legal apparatus to govern a modern private sector that was then simply extended to cover foreign investment. In fact, it was pretty much the opposite, rather. That is, that in many cases, China first created the rules, regulations, systems to deal with foreign enterprises, and then a lot of those systems were then extended to cover an emerging indigenous private sector. And so in part, the step-by-step process was because the administrative capacity and the legal capacity and the regulatory capacity had to be built up. Another thing that we have to remember when we look at China's policy towards foreign investment is that the objective function that China has had is simply different than the objective function that one would tend to see in Western countries. Most Western countries, foreign investment is looked at as a way of creating jobs, creating economic activity. And in China, that's certainly one of the things that foreign investment is supposed to do. But much more important in the Chinese context has been the focus on foreign investment as a mechanism to create a dynamic that improves Chinese companies and their ability to compete both domestically and internationally. So when Westerners say, well, why don't you open your economy more, you'll get greater GDP growth, sometimes they get blank stares in return because sometimes that's not the key objective. Because China doesn't want an economy that's dominated by foreign enterprises. And in fact, if you look at the sort of push-pull evolution of China's policy towards foreign investment, China has opened up, become more liberal, and more certain in terms of its foreign investment regime in response to the needs of foreign companies to have a more certain, secure environment and to adjust their risk-reward trade-off. So within China, it's always been the trade-off between potential loss of control or impingement on sovereignty on the one hand versus economic benefits on the other. And for the foreign companies, it's obviously been the real-time risk-reward trade-off. And what China found is that as it wanted more and higher quality foreign investment, that it had to evolve its policy regime towards foreign investment. And it took a long time for both the international players and for the Chinese officials to understand that when the foreigners said you should adopt international standards, that this was not because international meant good in some sense, but rather that what has evolved over decades, if not centuries, as international practice in governing foreign investment has evolved in order to generate a set of practical solutions to those exact trade-offs of sovereignty and control versus economic benefits for the countries and the risk-reward trade-offs of the companies. Okay. And if we don't keep that in mind, and if we don't keep track also that the objective function for China when it comes to foreign investment can just be different than other countries, we're not going to understand the game. We're not going to understand the history, nor are we going to understand the future. Right? So it's been a process of mutual discovery, and that process is ongoing today. I'll say just a couple of words about the vast Chinese literature on multinational companies and foreign investment impact. One of the striking features of the Chinese literature is that the vast majority of this literature actually doesn't discuss whether foreign investment is good for China or China's economy per se. The majority of this literature, in fact, the vast majority of this literature, focuses on whether foreign investment is a good thing or a bad thing for Chinese firms. And that's a very different point of view, right? It harkens back to this notion of what the objective function is. And while on most measures, it's pretty unambiguous that foreign investment has been a good thing for China and China's overall economic development, depending on the location and the sector, you can get some varied results in terms of whether it's been good for individual sets or individual industries when it comes to Chinese companies. The other thing about this literature, and I don't want to go on in detail about it, is that because a lot of this literature has not been in the international review and refereeing process, and a fair amount of it seems to be trying to mimic what the political winds are at the time, there are a lot of issues. There are a lot of issues about variable selection, interpretation, even proper statistical methods. Some of this literature, for example, tries to equate or relate GDP growth in a given year to foreign investment growth in that same year. The trouble with that is that maybe that impact is not in the same year, right? Let's do the thought experiment. You only allow foreign investment in even years, and it takes a year to ramp up the factory to make the investment and to really get the economic activity going. If the typical economist saw that data and did the analysis, you would get a perfectly negative correlation between growth in foreign investment and growth in economic output, right? Perfectly negative. And while this is an oversimplification and an exaggeration, if you peel away a lot of the papers that are out there, actually they fall into this trap. Okay? So there's a lot of stuff out there. It's got to be taken with a grain of salt. But part of the reason why I raise this is that this literature actually is influential in feeding into the policy regime within China. And most of the rest of the world doesn't even know this literature exists. Okay? Some of the obvious, the facts and figures, by 2015, there was $1.8 trillion U.S. dollars of cumulative investment into China. The red bar here is just the first 7 months of this year. We now have the first nine months, at least I have. The first 9 months of this year, China received about $95 billion U.S. dollars in foreign investment, which puts us on track for about $125 to $130 billion this year. We do notice that over the last 5-6 years, there's been a slowdown in the growth rate with a bit up and down. But still, $120, $130 billion, you know, that sounds like a whole lot of money, right? And it is. But again, increasingly in some circles, particularly in China, they say, well, that might be a lot of money in absolute terms, but in relative terms, it actually isn't. Because if we look at foreign direct investment as a percentage of gross capital formation in China, it's sort of 3% and declining in importance. So you foreign investors, you may have been useful in the past, but hey, to a first approximation, you're irrelevant and becoming less relevant each year. Or if we look at foreign investment in fixed assets as a percentage of total fixed asset investment, just a bit over 1% and declining. So even less relevant. And declining in relevance each year. And even if we look at trade, where foreign invested enterprises still account for over 50% of China's imports and just under 50% of China's exports, if you look at the net export contribution of the foreign invested enterprises into China, that peaked at about 4% of GDP about 10 years ago, and in the last couple of years it's been sort of 2%, a little under, holding steady. So again, thank you, foreign invested enterprises in the past, but you know, what have you done for us lately? And often, when I'm up in Beijing these days, this is where the discussion starts. But the issue is that there are other ways of looking at this, and other ways of looking at how foreign investment influences an economy. One is to go sector by sector. And on average, the more advanced the sector in China, the higher the influence and importance of foreign invested enterprises. In the consumer sector, this is 2014 data, 72% of the revenue was generated by foreign invested enterprises. In the auto sector, just under 50%. And basically, if you look at the more advanced industries in the manufacturing sector anyway, you see foreign invested enterprises 30%, 40% of the relevant measures, be they sales, be they profits, be they employment, be they value added. And if we take the industrial sector as a whole, which is roughly these days 50%, roughly half of China's economy, if you take mining, manufacturing, construction, utilities rather, it's about 50% of the economy, and foreign invested enterprises account for over 20%, again, of all the relevant measures, including value added. Which means that just the foreign invested enterprises in the industrial sector by themselves account for about 10% of GDP, just their value added, which is a little different than 1%. It's a little different than 2%, a little different than 4%. But we can go significantly farther. In fact, we can go farther if we treat inward investments into China like we would treat them if we were trying to assess doing a new investment in a local economy. So for example, our little company, Enright Stop Associates, we did the economic impact analysis of doing a third runway here in Hong Kong. And the economic impact of the Marina Bay Sands integrated resort in Singapore, and a bunch of other investments around the region and around the world. And when you do that type of analysis, there are standard tools and techniques that have been used for long periods of time that are generally accepted. And what these techniques allow you to do is look not just at the investment itself, but at the operations of the invested enterprises, and then the ripple effect back through the supply chain. That's the indirect impact. And then the impact of the consumer spending of both the direct operating foreign invested enterprises and the employees of all the companies in the supply chain. That's the induced impact. And then there's catalytic, which is sort of everything else. And I'll come back to that a little later. But if we just take this direct, indirect, and induced impact of the foreign investment and the foreign invested enterprises in China, what we estimate is that these combined account for about 33% of China's GDP, and as Merle indicated, about 27% of employment. And the GDP numbers are actually pretty stable. They're not going down, in large part because you have the operations of these enterprises built up with the $1.8 trillion worth of cumulative investment. And how does this break down? How should we think about this 33%? Well, 10% I already told you, right? Actually, it's about 11.5%. That's just the value added of foreign invested enterprises themselves in the industrial sector. That's purely out of China's statistics, and the statistics reported on the foreign invested enterprises are about as good as you get in China because they're directly reported by the companies. They're not estimated, okay? And if anything, there's an incentive for the companies to underreport so they pay lower taxes rather than overreport. So that's about 11%. Then if we do the ripple effect through the supply chains of those companies, that gives us nearly another 9-10%, which would be common in the US or any other major economy. Then we have the physical investment itself, putting the bricks and mortar in the ground, the support services, and then the ripple effect through that supply chain. That's about 3% or so. And then, so we're up now, what? We're up about 23-24%. Then if we make incredibly conservative assumptions about the service sector, because the service sector data isn't as good. But if we make the assumption that foreign invested enterprises in the service sector in China are no more productive than their domestic counterparts, and then we work that assumption through the supply chains, their supply chains, we get about another 11-12%. And that adds up to the 33%. And we think that these numbers are underestimated rather than overestimated, particularly in the service sector, because since the mid-1990s, more than 50% of all the foreign investment in China has actually been into the service sector. And they tend to have larger local multipliers because they don't source as much in the way of imported goods, etc. Now, it's a little complicated to do this. You have to remove all the double counting and things like that. But we've done all that. And we've done that in, we think, are very defensible ways. So we think our 33% is actually significantly understated. In addition to that, because it understates the impact in the service sector. In addition, by the way, we recognize that there are many countries represented here. Basically, the tools and techniques we've developed to do this sort of analysis can be used in any country where there's a reasonable input-output table, which includes all of these countries within Asia, and where we can get the foreign investment and the revenues of foreign invested enterprises broken down by sector in some reasonable way. So for many of the countries represented in this room, it's actually possible to do a similar sort of analysis. Now that's just the impact that we can quantify pretty directly. In addition to that, what's not included in those estimates are the impacts of foreign investment in terms of modernizing industries and companies within China. You know, modernizing the Chinese banks in part through competition and the presence of foreign enterprises. It doesn't include the impact of developing indigenous Chinese companies as suppliers and distribution channels that can then benefit the Chinese economy as a whole. It doesn't include the domestic spillovers of the 1,500 R&D centers that foreign invested enterprises have put in China. it doesn't count the spillover into the domestic economy of the thousands of engineers and managers and the tens, if not hundreds of thousands, of primary and secondary students who have been educated in programs funded by foreign invested enterprises. It doesn't include the impact of bringing modern business and professional standards into China, like ISO standards or international caliber accounting standards and business practices. It doesn't include foreign companies, the accounting firms, the investment banks, giving indigenous Chinese companies access to global capital markets. It doesn't include the fact that foreign enterprises handle over 75% of China's cargo, enabling China to be the world's leading trading entity. It does not include the impact of foreign enterprises bringing in world-class environmental and CSR standards, etc., etc., etc. In fact, in many ways, the things that those quantitative estimates don't include are probably as important, if not more important, than what we can actually quantify. And when people ask me, well, how should we think about this? I say, well, think about comparing China and India. In 1980, when China started opening up, China's GDP and India's GDP were almost identical. Last year, India's GDP was about $2 trillion, and China's was $11 trillion. And if I'm asked for the main reasons for that, I think there are three. One is difference in terms of education, particularly literacy and numeracy among the female population. The second is urbanization, that China is much more urbanized, and that makes people accessible both as producers and consumers. And the third one is openness to foreign investment and the amount of foreign investment that's coming. So again, we're quite comfortable with our numbers because they don't even include all of these impacts, which again, we believe are equally, if not more, important. And when we look at individual cities, we see the same story. In Shanghai, for example, just the foreign invested enterprises, no estimate of their supply chains, no estimate of the consumer spending, just the foreign invested enterprises themselves account for 2/3 of exports, imports, and gross industrial product, 1/3 of tax revenue and employment. And in fact, if you want to think about the high-tech economy in Shanghai, which is supposed to be one of China's tech leaders, according to official Shanghai statistics, foreign invested enterprises accounted for 83% of high-tech output in 2004, and after a decade of pushing indigenous innovation, accounted for 90% of high-tech output in Shanghai in 2014. So in Shanghai, without the foreign invested enterprises, to a first approximation, you simply do not have a tech sector. And if you don't have a tech sector in Shanghai without the foreign enterprises, you don't have one pretty much anywhere else in China either. And if we look at the major initiatives that Shanghai has to develop its economy to the next level and the next level, a lot of that is, you know, embedded in hopes for the Shanghai Free Trade Zone, which not only involves but requires more and higher quality foreign investment. Shenzhen, of course, just north of us here, wouldn't exist in its present form without the foreign investment and the trade that that's generated. The foreign invested enterprises just in the industrial sector, including the supply chain impact, account for over 40% of GDP, and if we threw in the services, it would be closer to 60% of GDP. And just the net exports of the foreign invested enterprises, 20% of GDP. And again, if we look at the strategies that Shenzhen has to develop its economy, it's about building the foreign headquarters, R&D, and financial institution economy. Again, I won't go on with all the details. If we look at Tianjin, the major initiatives are in the Binhai New Area, which again, not only involve but require foreign investment. And a place like Chongqing, a much later developer, Chongqing produced 0 personal computers in the year 2007. This year will produce about 1/3 of the world's personal computers, and all of that is due to foreign invested enterprises. And again, all the chief initiatives in Chongqing, particularly the ones around the Liangjiang New Area, depend heavily on foreign investment. And if we look to companies and different groups of companies, as Merle indicated, Hong Kong pioneers have been quite prominent. Not just the tens of thousands of small and medium-sized manufacturing companies that have invested in Guangdong and elsewhere, but also, you know, the first toll roads. In many second and third tier cities, the first good hotel, the first good mixed-use complex that allows a city in China to become user-friendly. Leading investors in the real estate sector, in public utilities, etc., still come from Hong Kong. If we look at individual companies, a company like Procter & Gamble brought completely new product categories to China. Disposable diapers didn't exist as a product in China before P&G entered. And in some parts of rural China, toothbrushing was not normal practice until P&G's public health investments popularized toothbrushing. P&G has invested in building supply chains, not just to supply its China operations, but that now supply its global operations. And P&G has collaborated with the Chinese government to help develop over 10,000 distributors, which have helped the consumer economy in China develop. P&G is even a net exporter of managerial talent from China. There are far more Chinese nationals working in senior management positions for P&G outside of China than there are foreign expats working in senior management positions inside of China. So, and this is a single company. And when we look in more detail, just using publicly available information, P&G says they've invested about $2.5 billion in China over a few decades now, and that their sales in China are about $5.5 billion, at least they were, US dollars in 2014. And if we look at the AC Nielsen point of sales data for P&G products and use their estimates of $10 billion worth of sales, that gives you the retail wholesale distribution markup, which turns out to be roughly the same percentage as you'd see in the US. And if we take those numbers and work it through our analysis, I'll just come to the bottom line. We estimate that that entire system, P&G, their upstream suppliers, their downstream distributors, the supply chains of those companies, the consumer spending of all the relevant employees, supports about $11 billion in GDP in China and over 600,000 jobs, even though P&G itself may only employ about 20,000. I mentioned that the only company we had seen historically that had done this sort of analysis was Coca-Cola. In 1999, they estimated Coke, which at that time employed about 18,000 people in China, that their entire system through the bottlers, distributors, suppliers, supported about 450,000 jobs. Okay? So what we're saying is that when people just tone up the investment amount, and the number of jobs that maybe those foreign invested enterprises themselves have created, that this is just the tip of the iceberg. And to get a much more complete story, we have to work through the whole situation. I'll just flip forward another interesting company, Samsung. Samsung may be the largest single foreign direct investor in China. It's invested about $15 billion in China over a two-decade period. And P&G has almost been the poster child for foreign investment. They've created a virtual, complete, duplicate Samsung in China. They do everything from basic R&D to advanced components. It's not just assembly stuff. And in fact, the vice chair of Samsung globally is the head of the China operation. And they've received numerous awards from Chinese sources as being the best foreign investor in China. But even if Samsung, as costs have increased in China, as there's been some pushback against foreign companies, they may have invested over $15 billion in China, but just over a 5-6 year period, they've invested about $14 billion in Vietnam. So when it comes to sources of production, there are alternatives. And there is investment, and there are investors that are looking to either augment their Chinese facilities or, in some cases, replace their Chinese facilities with facilities somewhere else in the region. Somewhere else in Asia, normally, because that's where the supply chains are. very difficult to move that to North America or Europe where the, when the supply chains are based here in Asia. And that provides enormous opportunities, again, for some of the countries represented in this room. So what are some of the implications for this? For China, it's pretty straightforward. China's been remarkably successful in being able to manage the process of bringing in foreign investment. And even though it may have been problematic for a number of foreign investors, they have created a regime, they have created enough certainty to allow foreign investors to come in and benefit the companies while benefiting China. But going forward, we would urge Chinese officials to think about how to get to the next level and the next level and the next level in China's economy. Because those are the things, the cutting edge aspects of China's economy, that's where the foreign enterprises still lead the domestic enterprises by a significant margin. And if China starts closing off its economy to foreign investment today, it may be able to replace a lot of what the foreign companies do today, but what about tomorrow? And what about the day after that? And what about the day after that? Because quite frankly, no country can come up with all the ideas necessary to continue to develop their economy. When it comes to other countries, it's that first off, that the benefits of foreign direct investment are hugely underestimated and understated in the global literature. And that it's really incumbent on each country to work through the entire set of ripple effects that the foreign investment can create. A second point is that it's possible to manage the process. If there's concern about sovereignty, about loss of control, if there's concern about wiping out the indigenous economy, that these issues can be managed if they're managed carefully. And quite frankly, in many industries for developing countries, the best way to develop the industry is to allow foreign investment and then to get the natural spin-offs, the natural spillovers that come into the economy. When it comes to workforce development, rather than forcing foreign companies to hire locals, you know, at all ranks, even senior management ranks, much better usually to let the foreign companies come in because they have every incentive to localize their skilled activities as quickly as possible. It's much better for them. If you look at places like Japan, very few foreign companies today have expats in senior management capacities. And in China today, again, a company like P&G will have very few expats in senior management activities. Those get developed, they get developed largely by the foreign invested enterprises. China wants to develop, other countries want to develop their service sectors, their tech sectors. Foreign investment's a good way of doing it. And quite frankly, that's been the case for hundreds of years. It was, you know, railroads that foreigners invested in that built the U.S. economy. And the U.S. pharmaceutical industry got its start with foreign investment that then created local dynamics, trained local people, and the spin-offs and the spillovers resulted in the U.S. companies and enterprises that we see today. And then finally, for the multinational companies themselves, and for the source countries and their representative business organizations, it's that, you know, there's a lot more information and analysis potentially at your disposal to make the case for why a more open foreign investment regime is good for host countries. As we said before, there are very few companies that have done this analysis. Most chambers of commerce and business councils simply don't have the firepower to carry out this type of analysis. It's doable, not easy, but it's doable, and it gives much better ammunition to sort of make the case. Because again, our standpoint, we don't come at this with a notion of this is good or this is bad. What we come with is the approach that says, let's get the information, let's get the data on the table. Each country, each company needs to make its own decisions, but we urge all companies and all countries to make those decisions with as much information analysis as possible, and we think when that's done, that companies and countries will be able to take back some of that money that they're leaving on the table. And that will promote their own development as well as the development of their own companies and their own people. And with that, I will stop my prepared remarks and open it up to questions and comments from the group.
Thank you.
question, just in the back.
Well, first of all, my name is Andrew Lam. I'm a China strategist. And first of all, thank you for sharing your insightful findings with us. Your findings have been extremely professional. So based on what's happened so far, so my question to you is that China's, for example, manufacturing is set for a sea change with the launch of the Make in China 2025. You're focusing a number of important sectors. So how would some of the numbers change in terms of employment, and also with China's continued emphasis on indigenous innovation? So how would this change with the Make in China 2025 strategy? And perhaps as an aside, how would Trump mess up the scenario?
Okay. China's, again, China has to come to decisions on several features. China wants a more advanced manufacturing economy. China is pushing that, at least in part, in some sectors, focusing exclusively on indigenous development. The push for indigenous development, indigenous innovation, is a good thing as long as it doesn't exclude foreign investment. Because if you look at what underlies China's need to modernize its manufacturing, it's going to need a whole lot of robotics, integrated management systems that Chinese companies themselves cannot supply. That these days, the complex, huge automated production systems are largely the arena of foreign companies. So while in some sectors, and we do see, and we have seen over time, Chinese companies improve and become more important in individual sectors, that doesn't eliminate the need for the foreign companies to operate in the more advanced sectors. Will they get squeezed out over time? We don't think likely. We think that in the future, the share of the foreign enterprises might go down a bit, but not that much, because they're growing with China, right? And if that means if the foreign enterprises and all the ripple effects, remember, the ripple effects are mostly Chinese companies. And if we think of 2/3 of the GDP by indigenous economies and indigenous companies and a significant portion of the supply chain, we see that the foreign companies in China actually have a multiplier effect. They increase industrial development in China. They don't limit it. So for China to be moving forward to manufacturing 2025 and beyond, our view is that foreign companies need to be part and parcel of that improvement process. In terms of indigenous innovation, supporting indigenous innovation, we think is a great idea. But not if it excludes foreign enterprises or limits the ability of foreign enterprises to invest in developing R&D and intellectual capital in China. The part of the indigenous innovation program that has tried to force foreign companies to share source codes, to share technology, has been counterproductive to China. We have many multinational clients, we advise on their China activities, who have dramatically reduced the research and development that they would have done in China because of that. The way for any developing country to develop those skills and capabilities is to accept the foreign investment and then to have the skills and capabilities develop in the local population. Then you get the spill-offs, then you get the spin-offs. There have been hundreds, literally hundreds of high-tech companies just in Beijing that have spun out of the big foreign companies. And that's the way that developing companies push the local technology economy. China is unique in that it has the size and it has the capacity to absorb that without its indigenous economy getting wiped out. So we think that focusing on enhancing manufacturing and automation and innovation in the manufacturing sector, that's a great thing. Pushing indigenous innovation, that's a great thing. Except when it restricts the activities of foreign firms, because that's actually, in many cases, a more effective mechanism for upgrading and improving the innovation performance of the local economy. In terms of a Trump factor, hey, it can go anyway. But what I would say is that we have to remember that foreign enterprises, they invest internationally more to sell things than to make things and export. Foreign invested enterprises in China sell 2.73 times in China what they export out of China. And foreign invested enterprises are the leading importers into China, right? Because they bring their international supply chains with them. So when it comes to issues of potential currency manipulation, potential state support, that is an area where there is a reasonable argument to be had between the US and China. My view is that the two economies are so important to each other that we'll see a modus vivendi. It may be the balance gets shifted a bit, but it's in both countries' interest to develop that modus vivendi. And they both have to operate within their own systems, so that means the US has to operate within its own legal environment, and they're both members of the WTO, so ultimately anything that happens is potentially subject to WTO resolution if there are any disputes. Next, so question over here, and then there's one over here. So right there, and okay, from here, then here. Okay, let's go here, and then there's a gentleman here.
Michael, Mark Michelson, we know each other a little bit. Thanks for the follow-up on this. Just a follow-up on the question. You have some powerful ammunition for making the case for FDI in China and other countries as well. Have you found examples of this being communicated successfully to people who make a difference in terms of it? Because as you know, various surveys we've seen from the American Chamber, from the European Chamber, you mentioned Samsung, have felt, rightly or wrongly, that the environment's actually gone downhill a little bit in the past few years. Not in every sector, not in ones that they need, but nevertheless, that's another area. And then as a side question, on the follow-up on the, I heard there was an election last week in the United States, to follow up on that. What about the issue of national security? Because that affects investment in both places to some extent. And that's been the big problem that many Chinese investors have had going in the United States. That could be retaliation from the Chinese side. If that continues under the Trump administration, we don't have any idea whether it will. But anyway, just those two.
In terms of getting the message out, quite frankly, this is early days. This is the launch of this work in Hong Kong. So this is the first time we've presented this work in Hong Kong. We presented the work in Washington. The initial book launch was at the Center for Strategic and International Studies in Washington. We had a good turnout from the think tanks there. We've had presentations at Harvard in Boston. We've had presentations in New York. We've had presentations in Shanghai with the U.S. and European Chambers of Commerce. We'll be in Beijing later this month, meeting for the first time with Chinese officials and also with the international business community here. So what we're trying to do is put this information in the hands of relevant people. We also, in Washington, met with the U.S. China Business Council, etc. So we're trying to put it in the hands of the international business community so they can see, hey, let's do a more detailed and sophisticated assessment of our impact so that we can tell our story to a much greater extent than has been told. We're trying to put it into the hands of Chinese officials. We have not done that as of yet. As I said, we start that later in the month in Beijing and say, well, look, you know, you've been actually very successful. And even though it's, you know, foreign companies and countries have complained over time, you know, you've been very successful in attracting investment that has had a huge impact on your economy while retaining sovereignty, retaining control, etc. However, you know, some companies are looking elsewhere. And if you want the type of investment that takes you to the next level, look at the strategies of your own leading cities. And look how reliant they are on foreign investment. And look at your own proven past that as China's wanted to develop the next stage, it had to be a little more open, a little friendlier, a little more certain to foreign investment in order to get there. So don't believe the press clippings too early, okay? And then to other countries, it's, as I said, it's the example. And we had a good meeting this morning with the Indonesian Consul General and many of his staff and members of the Indonesian community. We're willing to do outreach to other communities as well to get this information into their hands, to again get across the notion that we can do the analysis. There is a set of more sophisticated tools out there. It is possible to do a more complete assessment. And then, once one has that assessment, one can try to make the case. Because it's not just making the case to companies or to government officials. In many cases, it's making that case to public opinion. You know, one analysis we haven't done as of yet, but we could do, and maybe it's a project for the future, is the complete impact of China's investment into the U.S. Where again, the only numbers that we see these days are aggregate investment numbers and a first approximation of just what the Chinese companies directly do in terms of employment in the US, with no estimate of the ripple effect back through the supply chain and consumer spending, et cetera. So it's just early days, and quite frankly, you know, it's groups like you. Right? And if you look around the room and look at the business cards of who you've met here, you know, it's not accident, right? That we're trying to reach members of the international community who have either in their own communities, their own chambers of commerce, their own nations, an interest in understanding this agenda. Okay, so then next was here, yes, and then we'll go over here.
Thanks very much, Glenn Chai from the Hong Kong American Center. Thank you for this good research and report. I wanted to ask, what do you observe or what do you expect to see as China takes its learning from hosting inbound FDI to going out and being a source of FDI elsewhere in the world, including the U.S.? I mean, that's part of the ripple effects in a way, the learning that has occurred, that's changed the system, and now you know, China is a source for outbound FDI in a large way. And what do you observe that they, in a sense, took from the experience of hosting that they relates to their going out? The related question is, you mentioned something about the investment treaty. If you had anything to say about where you think that is, it sounded pretty good, but we might.
Okay, I'll also pick up on the portion of Mark's question that I ignored. In terms of what China has learned by hosting, I think it has learned by hosting that world-class companies can only be world-class companies if they're international. That no one country has all the good ideas. That in order for Chinese companies to be successful competing domestically, they're going to have to be successful competing internationally. And this is, in significant part, the rationale behind pushing Chinese companies to go global, to go international. One of the things, or a number of the things that they are learning in going international is that, well, when they go international, other countries have national security concerns too. And other countries have concerns when it comes to playing fields that are on level. And other countries have concerns and start using the words reciprocity. And other countries have their own rules and regulations when it comes to foreign investment. And you can't just go and operate in the U.S. or Australia or Japan as a Chinese company would within China. So I think what we're finding is that more so than the learnings hosting and applying those internationally, that much more we will see what Chinese companies run up against internationally will affect what they do in terms of hosting. That they may have a situation in China where government in certain sectors is behind the companies and is behind the company's internationalization. But as long as that's the case, then it's going to be very difficult for many foreign countries to treat that inbound investment as if it's a pure private sector investment. And when that happens, or when that doesn't happen, it means they're under different conditions when it comes to foreign investment reviews. Okay? And China will have to learn that. And as Chinese companies go international, even into environments that in some ways are much more open than their own environment, they do get pushback. So the sort of clash of systems is occurring. And what the challenge to the Western and the OECD countries in particular is, how do they deal with Chinese inbound investment while keeping true to their own rules, regulations, laws, and objective functions when it comes to foreign investment, when China has a very different system, in part because their objective function when it comes to foreign investment is different. And that's where, again, where the modus vivendi will have to be met. Now, in that process, remember there are big issues in the US with Japanese outbound investment. And how did that get dealt with? It got dealt with in part by negotiation, in part economic rationale. Eventually, if you're selling into a major market, you want to be producing it. Right? That's just the way it is. It's the way for US companies in China. It's the same way for Chinese companies into the US. And that we're already seeing that happen. So each country has its own national security issues, its own national policy issues, right? Media investment by foreign enterprises is restricted in the US, airline investment is restricted, there are a whole bunch of restricted sectors in the US. That would be common in any country, right? And we're gonna see that, and that's gonna vary country by country. But I think what's gonna happen is, as China's investment regime evolves, it will evolve in significant part as others treat China and their investments. Yes, I think
you're
over here, yes.
I'm Jesus Eade from Plymouth University. Michael, congratulations on a very comprehensive, very necessary, compelling study and analysis. As a former WTO person myself, I very much welcome your focus and attention to trade and sustainable development in this age when the world seems to have lost the compass on trade. There are so many pressures on protectionism, not protectionism, regional efforts. The TPP is one. In that context, a major focus of China's political rhetoric has been the Belt and Road Initiative. Absent from your talk, because that's not your topic, it's a completely major alternative issue. But my question to you is, with this initiative, which at the very least signifies a major effort by China to open a new direction for economic activity, trade, investment, everything towards its west, how do you see that affecting China's integration with the global economy, with the major advanced economies in particular, as a big backdrop question? And then more specifically, what should foreign firms do to ensure they get an important piece of the pie through investment and or through trade, if the B&R initiative does become as big as they say it might become? Thank you.
Okay, and I'll also link it back to the current work as well, because, and in part the last bit of it, is that what we're seeing is that, you know, there are enormous number of projects involved in One Belt, One Road. And actually, again, my company is actually doing the One Belt, One Road for two foreign countries that are asking those questions. And what we see is, again, it's a huge effort on the part of China to further integrate with the rest of the world from a trade side and an investment side. And again, we think that's completely consistent with them looking at their own inward investment and understanding the value that that creates. In addition, as China goes international through One Belt, One Road, there are many businesses, there are many technologies that they will need to use which they don't have indigenously, that they will have to bring in foreign partners. And there are many markets in which they're not familiar. And foreign companies are quite familiar with. So we're seeing among our corporate clients, companies being able to successfully engage with China by saying, okay, we need to invest in China to develop the types of skills and capabilities that China needs in order to properly address this One Belt, One Road opportunity. We're seeing some of those same companies saying, we will be partners in developing the technologies, the procedures, the practices, the management structures, the communication requirements that One Belt, One Road entail. And again, we're also seeing companies say, well, okay, One Belt, One Road implies a whole lot of China outbound investment, but those countries are only going to be accepting China outbound investment in a number of cases if China is open to inbound investment from their companies. So we're seeing One Belt, One Road being a major initiative. We're seeing it potentially succeeding in a number of ways where past efforts have failed. Some people say, well, if One Belt, One Road were economic, it would already have happened. But China involved is perhaps willing to provide below market finance. It's potentially willing to act as a catalyst, and it's potentially willing to operate as an interlocutor with governments, particularly in Central Asia, which have been difficult to deal with. And that may all come to fruition. But remember, One Belt, One Road is not just overland towards Central Asia, Europe. It's also Southeast Asia overland. It's also the ports that are all around the Pacific Rim, leading to South Asia into Europe. It's a very broad agenda. Again, we believe that China itself doesn't have the financial capability or the technical capability to fully implement One Belt, One Road on its own, and that creates opportunities for foreign companies both inside and outside of China. And then again, the companies we're working with are putting the two together. They're saying, we can help you with your One Belt, One Road initiative. You need to help us in developing the skills and capabilities in China to support that. We can only do that if we're allowed to invest, if we're allowed to expand, if we're allowed to invest in China as we're investing with China in One Belt, One Road. Yes.
Thank you. Bill Stacey from the Hinrich Foundation. How does the case for foreign direct investment relate to the case for openness of capital markets and portfolio investment?
Okay. First, I'll answer the part of the previous question that I didn't answer, which was on trade and pushback on trade in general. Again, there are others in the room who are expert. I think when it comes to both trade and investment, be it both inward and outward investment, that particularly in the democratic countries, that the case has not been made to the common person, to the working class person, to why it is that trade and investment benefits them. It's quite clear that it's benefited the elites in the advanced countries because they have access to cheaper sources of production and they have access to wider markets. It's very clear that it's benefited enormously the bulk of the populations in many developing countries that have become part of the global economy. What is not clear in many advanced countries is whether the working class individual has been helped or harmed. And that's where a lot more assessment needs to be done. And that's where the thought has to be done about how the gains from trade and the gains from investment get distributed, okay? And because it's not automatic that everybody benefits. And too many, again, my doctorate's in economics, way too many economists say, it's a solved problem, trade benefits everyone. Well, trade doesn't benefit everyone necessarily. It may benefit the aggregate, but then we need to think about how that works for different groups and how to get the distribution of that right. So that's that question. And here just
capital markets. And portfolio investment.
Again, not something that we've discussed directly or studied directly as part of this project in the context of China. But basically more open capital markets give you some of the same thing. They give you access to more capital. They give you access to internationally knowledgeable capital. And so far, you know, China's been able to attract a lot of foreign portfolio investment. It's done, you know, lots of IPOs, lots of venture capital investment, lots of private equity investment. Could it have done more? The answer is yes. You still see who can list in public capital markets tightly restricted. So more can be done. The portfolio investment, yeah, the question there is, what does the portfolio investment actually do? If the portfolio investment from local and international sources supplements the domestic capital market, if it puts new assets in the ground, creating jobs, creating economic activity, great. If it just drives up or down temporarily local asset prices, then, you know, less valuable, long-term stability, more challenge. So again, you know, separate from this project, you know, I have a certain amount of sympathy for countries that want to restrict large short-term capital flows. But obviously being open to more international capital helps many countries break the budget constraint. We look, again, I won't name names, but there are countries in Southeast Asia where, you know, where two-thirds or more of the capital stock is foreign investment. If we look at countries like Australia and New Zealand, well, they would be nowhere without foreign direct investment, and their capital markets wouldn't be nearly as large and deep as they are today without portfolio investment from foreign countries. But again, portfolio investment, you know, one does have to worry about hot money coming in and out, because for small countries in particular, and small countries with maybe less stable economies, that can be problematic. In general, good, better to be open, but safeguards for hot money, I have sympathy with. Other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
Anders Heaton, British Chamber of Commerce. Thank you, Michael, for a very interesting and compelling presentation. You gave a very strong case why you thought the Chinese authorities should take a forward-looking, accommodating view to further foreign investment, particularly in relation to their ambitions in technology and so on. But I think if you look at the situation at the moment, you touched on this, there's a rather contradictory picture. On the one hand, you've got the new foreign investment law, which on paper does look a considerable step forward, the move to the whole sort of negative list principle and so on. You've got the effort going into the new free trade zones in Shanghai and now spreading elsewhere. On the other hand, if you talk to the major foreign chains of commerce, big foreign companies in China, there's a fairly steady drumbeat about actually life getting more difficult on the ground, their prospects looking less good than they were 5 years ago, 6 years ago, you know, specific complaints about the new cyberspace law, so forth and so on. Now, I think if you look at the history of foreign investment in China, it's of course, you know, not been nicely smooth and linear, because that's not how life works. But I'm just wondering, you know, from your perspective, I mean, is there anything you could say about that apparently contradictory trends in Chinese policy? You know, do they reflect wider sort of differences of opinion in the leadership about economic reform and so on? And you know, anything you could say about the likely outcome from all this? I think at the moment, a lot of foreign companies are finding that prospect actually really quite uncertain and quite difficult.
Yeah, what we see is it really comes down sector by sector. That there are some sectors in China that, for national security reasons, China will just not be open. And there are other sectors, for industrial policy reasons, or some combination of security and policy reasons, that China will push, to the extent possible, foreign companies out, domestic companies in. Then there are things like payment systems and things that involve large capital flows where China would far prefer to have its system be dominant, at least for China-related payments in China and globally, because they just don't want any foreign body to be able to either cut off those payments or to have access to the information on them. On the other hand, there are some sectors that are just under the radar screen. You know, does the Chinese leadership really care who's selling toothpaste in China? The answer is no. So there are a wide range of sectors that are just under the radar screen. And our clients in those sectors are saying, it's business as usual. That, yeah, you have to be a good citizen, but as long as you're a good citizen, you know, they're not seeing any particular pushback. Then there are some areas in which China has objectives that are more important than domestic control. So in other words, while in some environmentally related technologies, China has said, we want to dominate, in many others, they know that their environmental problems are bigger than indigenous companies can solve. So for many environmental technologies, energy efficient technologies, clean technologies, we're seeing the door wide open for foreign enterprises. And what the foreign enterprises have to understand is that one size doesn't fit all. They have to understand the sector they're in. They have to understand whether this is a national security issue, the sector, whether it is a prime national industrial policy sector, whether it's a beneath the radar screen and it doesn't matter, or if it's a sector that China is specifically looking for foreign enterprises to help them develop. And then what the foreign enterprises have to do is they have to do their homework. And they have to understand in detail what the Chinese imperatives are and how they, as a company, can do good business while helping China meet those imperatives. And that's the case that has to be made. And many foreign companies wait. They wait when each five-year program comes out so that people figure out what the implementing guidelines are. Or they even wait for the programs to come out in the first place rather than having input beforehand. We find far too few foreign companies understand that these rules, regulations, they're written and nobody knows how to implement them in China. And that the person they're dealing with on the other side of the table often doesn't even know the full extent of the rules and regulations. I'll give you a specific example in a big enough sector that no one will be able to reverse engineer the client. We were working with a foreign company that wanted to do a retail complex in Shanghai. And this was at a time where supposedly the central government had said, hey, time to push back on real estate. And we went through and found the line in the Shanghai five-year program, not the big one, but one of the little ones, where Shanghai will try to create internationally iconic shopping and retail zones using the skills and capabilities of international developers and international brands. And we're the ones who put that to our client, who could then put it to the person on the other side of the table who said, oh, is that what I'm supposed to be doing? So literally, one has to do that level of detail of homework and make the case for why it is that what the foreign invested enterprise wants to do or needs to do from a business standpoint matches what China needs to do. And if it's in a sector where there's going to be pushback, why it is that this other objective is more important than a Chinese company necessarily being the person or the entity providing it. It's really that level of detail. And some companies do a really, really good job on it, and other companies, quite frankly, don't. And the ones that we see succeeding are the ones that are identifying how it is they're going to help that national, provincial, local official meet their objectives by making decisions that are good for China and good for the company at the same time. And it really does. Some sectors, it's, hey, tough luck, you know, or good luck, you know, you're going to be beating your head against the wall. But on many, many other sectors, we see that if the winds are for pushback, that will be the approach of the officials on the other side of the table until they are specifically shown what it is in their governing documents tells them that they should be making this decision that's also good for the company. And what, again, I urge people not to think necessarily that the Chinese official on the other side of the table knows what's in all of those documents, right? It's up to the investing company sometimes to ferret that out and to help the officials interpret their documents and to meet their targets in reasonable ways.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you everyone for those questions. Thank you, Michael, for the passion that you bring to this topic of foreign direct investment in China. And thank you to the Enright Scott Associates team who are here today for the work, which has, it's been a long journey for us at the Hinrich Foundation. And I think we might just give Michael a round of applause for the work. Thank you to our Hinrich Foundation team for facilitating today, and to the Bursa and Stella team for pulling together the guests. And Tim Summers, thank you very much from Chinese University of Hong Kong and Chatham House. Thank you for being here and for kicking off the session today. We think it's notable at the Hinrich Foundation that foreign direct investment has contributed and continues to contribute a third of China's GDP and a quarter of China's employment. And we believe that it will continue to be important for China's economy. Many of you here are from other economies in the Asian region and from the US and Europe. And we hope that this book on foreign direct investment can help your own governments develop policy and your own companies make decisions about foreign direct investment. And that was, in fact, our purpose in instigating this piece of research and producing this book. Some of you may also wish us to give briefings to some of your own teams. We'd be very pleased to do that. For instance, this morning, we briefed a very large team from Indonesia who are very interested in attracting foreign direct investment for their own economic development. If you'd like to participate more in the work of the Hinrich Foundation, or you'd like to know more about us, then there's a number of us here today that you might like to talk to us about ways in which you could be involved. For instance, you could be involved in this kind of research and disseminating this kind of research. You might be interested in sponsoring scholars who are developing careers in trade. At the moment, we have 29 scholars in school learning how to be leaders in trade across the region. Or you might be interested in our program in developing Asia that helps small to medium enterprises find markets for their products and create employment in their communities. This is the work of the Hinrich Foundation, and Mr. Hinrich leads this work with us. He's very actively involved. And thank you very much for being interested in the work that we're doing on foreign direct investment. Thank you for coming today. And there's a copy of the book awaiting you as you leave. Thanks very much.